Tanter Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Freedom Farmers, Agricultural Resistance and the Black Freedom Movement by Monica M. White with LaDonna Redman, narrated by Monica M. White. Acknowledgments. There are many to thank for their support as I researched and wrote Freedom Farmers. I appreciate this opportunity to express my gratitude to those who have made this research process enriching, rewarding, and life-changing. Not unlike the unending ball of yarn, each question in this research led me to a person who was willing to not only answer, but who also asked further questions and connected me to others who were able to help me engage the topic of Black farmers and agricultural resistance at a deeper level. There are many projects upon which this one can be built, and this is only a first installment in unearthing the hidden narratives of Black farmers who create and participate in agricultural cooperatives as a strategy of resilience and resistance. When I found myself stuck in the research process, there were so many friends and colleagues who were willing to organize book club meetings, campus brown bag presentations, or community meetings where I was able to present my framework and talk through my findings. There were always those who extended themselves to me, who offered words of encouragement, or who connected me to someone new. For all those individuals not named here, but who offered endless advice and support in the writing process, I am grateful. To the members of the Detroit Black Community Food Security Network, you have become my family. Your work, vision, and drive helped me identify the questions that would give my life purpose and meaning. To Baba Malik, Mama Abba, Mama Ebony, Baba Kwamina, Mama Linda, Mama Nefera, and all the members of the Detroit Black Community Food Security Network, I am eternally grateful for the love, direction, patience, and endless support you have given to me and for all your efforts to transform a city, build a food movement, and to create a just and sustainable world. You taught me that home is a verb. There are many others in the Detroit food justice movement who have supported me, offered me chances to share my ideas, and pushed and loved me through all of it. Thanks especially to Ashley Atkinson of Keep Growing Detroit for early reads and for your support of this work, and Patrick Crouch of Earthworks Urban Farm. Other food justice activists have embraced this project and offered support and feedback. Mama Asantewa Harris, who introduced me to Freedom Farm many years ago, Blaine Snipstall of Black Dirt Farm, Dara Cooper, National Black Food Justice Task Force, LaDonna Redman, Campaign for Food Justice Now, Tracy McCurdy, the Black Belt Justice Center, Eric Holt Jimenez, Institute for Food and Development Policy, Drs. Ife and Taka Kilimanjaro, University of Kemet Press, Baba Rashid Nuri, Truly Living Well, Dr. Owusu Bandele, Southeast African American Farmers Organic Network, and the brilliant organizer and now ancestor, Mama Cynthia Hayes. I am so encouraged by all of you who do this work and your willingness to embrace these ideas as part of a framework for liberation. You all have supported my research ideas, offered me feedback, and showed me a reflection of myself and my work that made it easy to keep going. A huge thank you goes to my former colleagues at Wayne State University, David Fassenfest, Heidi Gottfried, and Sarah Swider, who have always believed in my work. Special thanks to David Goldberg for his early support and for directing me to additional research sources I would otherwise have missed. Thanks also to Carrie Ann Rockmore of the National Center for Faculty Development and Diversity, who in the Ideal Day exercise helped me realize a trajectory that would transform my career by convincing me that there was room for my ideas in the academy. To my friends in the African American Studies Department at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, you offered an early space to try out the logic of my approach, jumpstarting my intellectual inquiry into agricultural resistance. Lou Turner offered countless hours of reading and answering my calls, and along with his partner, Ruby Mendenhall, organized and hosted a writing group session in their home with friends and colleagues from UIUC. Helen Neville, Imani Bazell, Michael Flug, retired archivist from the Vivian Harsh Collection and the Carter G. Woodson Regional Library in Chicago. And Sophia and Otis Noble of the University of Southern California embraced the book idea and gave me hours of transcribed notes from feedback that helped shape the direction of the book. Also in attendance was Sundiata Chajua, who gave me the title Freedom Farmers, and has remained a constant source of support for this project from its early inception. Thanks also to Robert Zabawa at Tuskegee University, who opened his personal library and shared his resources and his time so freely. Special thanks to Kate Epstein, whose clarity and contributions made the writing process much easier. I'm indebted to my colleagues at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, who have been incredibly supportive of my work. There was never a request that you didn't fulfill. I am grateful to work with such brilliant, thoughtful, and giving colleagues. From day one, Paul Robbins of the Gaylord Nelson Institute for Environmental Studies has asked how he could support my work, and he has followed through with every request. Greg Mittman not only twisted my arm to convince me to come to Madison, but he has provided valuable advice and feedback. Bill Cronin challenged me to think about who I wanted to be as an intellectual and as an activist. Steve Ventura and Margaret Crome offered me love, their cabin, and a meal when the research process became overwhelming. Thank you to Nebby Hilliard, Mindy Thompson, Benjamin Ball, Bianca Baldridge, Erica Turner, and all the members of our writing group who offered regular conversations with lots of laughter and the support I needed to stay the path. To the members of the Department of Community and Environmental Sociology, thank you for the brown bags and faculty colloquia that you organized that helped me see my way through lots of directions and ideas. Jess Gilbert offered feedback on early drafts, shared intellectual resources, and connected me to people in the South. Jack Kloppenberg helped me find my voice with pointed questions and a loving and supportive hand. Noah Feinstein, you started off as my accountability buddy, and you've become my friend. Catherine Curtis, Leanne Tigas, Gary Green, Mike Bell, Randy Stoker, and Daniel Kleinman, you have supported these ideas from the beginning. Thanks to my colleagues in the UW-Madison Sociology Department, Pam Oliver, Alice Goffman, and others who offered feedback on theoretical and methodological approaches. Thanks to colleagues elsewhere who offered suggestions on previous versions of the manuscript and whose work inspired my own. Craig Harris, Michigan State University, David Brunsma, Virginia Tech University, April Mays, Pomona College, Tanya Golash-Boza, University of California, Merced, Kwasi Demsu, Florida A&M University, Dorsita Taylor, University of Michigan, Psyche Williams-Forson, University of Maryland, Ashante Reese, Spelman College, and LaShonda Pittman, University of Washington. A special thank you to Jessica Nimhardt at the John Jay College of Criminal Justice, who offered support and who demonstrated by example the way to build a narrative using disparate pieces of history to tell the story of freedom. To my research assistants at UW-Madison, Jacqueline Weipler, and Isaac Leslie, who have been especially helpful with coding and thinking about the broader implications of this project. You've taken my theoretical framework and made it your own. Thank you for your contributions. Thank you to the photographers who captured the images that tell stories, especially Patricia Guvdis, Jeremy Brockman, and Franklin Peterson. Thank you to the archivists and the keepers of organizational documents who provided the data for the research. Those who retain historical documents and records have a special place in the heart of an academic. Thanks to Dana Chandler, archivist at Tuskegee University, and to the archivists at the Amistad Collection at Tulane University, and the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, Mississippi Department of History, Wisconsin Historical Society, Birmingham Public Library, Alabama State Archives, and the Walter Reuther Archives. Many farmers have loved me and taught me so much. Thanks to Mr. Ben Burkett for all the introductions, for explaining historical and contemporary contexts, for answering all of my questions about the life of a farmer, and for taking me on the long drives between Petal, Mississippi and Epps, Alabama. You've trusted me with your knowledge, introduced me to fellow farmers, and accepted me as family, and I am forever indebted. Thanks also to Mr. Daniel Teague of the Mississippi Association of Cooperatives, Mr. George and Mrs. Alice Paris, Reverend Wendell Paris, and Mr. John Zippert of the Federation of Southern Cooperatives, Reverend and Mrs. Sherrod of New Communities, Reverend Jeff, Reverend Sarah Goldstein of Measure for Measure in Madison, who shared their memories of Mrs. Fannie Lou Hamer. I couldn't imagine a better team with whom to work than the editors at the University of North Carolina Press. Thanks to Brandon Proa, who consistently encouraged me to write the book that was my own, to Rhonda Williams, who offered so many brilliant suggestions, and who, with Heather Ann Thompson, has created a space for interdisciplinary work on civil rights and Black power. Thanks also to the anonymous reviewers. Jane Collins raised the bar and set the standard for what it means to be a mentor, a colleague, and a friend. As my doula for birthing this project, Jane reminded me to breathe, held my hand, and offered encouragement and endless edits. She was right there with me every step of the way. We've laughed and cried and celebrated together, and through it all, we became sisters. Your thoughtfulness and patience have meant so much to me. Thank you to my family, my maternal grandparents, Mr. Kenneth Brown and Miss Bessie Pearl Brown, my paternal grandmother, Miss Marilyn Triggs, my parents, Dr. Maurice O. White and Maggie B., and my sister Marilyn, who instilled in me a sense of curiosity about the world, courage, and a challenge to build community in order to make things better than I found them. I'm forever grateful for your introduction to the love of all that is intellectual. And to my partner in life, Anthony J. Spruer, you have offered me comfort, love, support, a family, and a sense of community. I can never thank you enough for all you've been to me and for all you've done. Foreword. When I first heard about Monica White's work, I was already looking, as she was, to fill in the blanks in the history of Black people's role in food justice that the dominant food movement narrative had left out. I wanted this for myself and for my son, whose birth was the impetus for my own journey into the world of food justice. I thought I was prepared to be a mother of a Black boy in the United States. I thought I understood the threats and obstacles that he would face because of his race and gender. I anticipated that he would need a proper education and all the traps that a Black boy must maneuver to become a man. I never imagined that the U.S. food and agricultural system would become part of the list of threats to his life. But he is allergic to eggs, peanuts, shellfish, and all dairy products. I wanted him to live free, and I knew that his survival was related to my ability to find out more about the food system. I had a family to feed. I had to do the practical work that would feed my family. Stewardship of urban land was my route to food activism that led to demanding food justice for me, my family, and my community. Working urban land to feed my son, I had uncovered a connection to the land that I did not expect. I learned that growing food was an act of resistance. This insight is also a central point of the book you hold in your hands. Growing food on the west side of Chicago, I was excited to learn that there were others across the country who were just as concerned about the food system. Yet it became clear very quickly that the predominantly white food movement saw the lack of healthy food in my community as a sign that we did not care for healthy food. Those in that movement blamed culture and poor food choices, not industrial agriculture. The solutions they proposed included food pantries, classes to teach healthy eating, and other remedies that tended to pathologize the culture rather than the food and agricultural industry. None of the suggestions ever promoted self-sufficiency. Thus, growing food became an act of resistance both to these faulty assumptions and to the system that failed to provide for us. This book extends that insight. The contributions of people of color and indigenous nations are missing in our understanding of food history. Our legacy has been erased. Manifest Destiny erased the contributions of Black and indigenous people to the United States. When I met Monica, I was looking for information that acknowledged and reclaimed the legacy of Black people in the founding of the food system in the United States. As a Black woman, being able to use another Black woman's work to honor the work of Black people, and especially Black women, is empowering. This book confirms what I knew had to be true. Black people have a historical connection to the land in the United States. The land ethic that Monica's work uncovered is our history, our way of being on land, our own terms with pride and dignity. Monica's work recognizes that we all must live in the gap between the truth of who we are and who we hope to become. Knowing the history of my people, the blank space in the dominant narrative of the agricultural, food, environmental movement made no sense. While the white food movement describes my community through a deficit model, Monica's work describes agriculture as a site of resistance. In my experience in the white food movement, if food was mentioned, it was to suggest that soul food, the traditional cuisine of African Americans, was unhealthy. When I wanted to convert vacant lots to urban farms, I was told that my community had no real role in the food system besides that of consumer. Researchers called our communities food deserts and favored large-scale food retailers as saviors of the community rather than urban agriculture or farmers markets operated for and by the community. The food movement's narrative made no reference to Black Americans' connection to the land, completely omitting the African slave trade and the institution of slavery in its narrative of American agriculture. Outside of that narrative, Black people's experience of agriculture has been understood as one of subjugation, hardship, and danger. Without betraying that history, Monica's work provides a counter-narrative, one of self-sufficiency, resistance, and a food justice movement that can serve Black people. This book reclaims our historical legacy of cooperation and shows that we can develop economically viable communities. White supremacy drove a wedge between us and our relationship to the land. The terror that our people faced in the past when working the land was real. We need to address the stigma that impacts the descendants of those who were enslaved and the cultural memory of the oppression, exploitation, and trauma of the sharecropping system. The land holds the key to unlocking the shackles of white supremacy. The land holds our healing. This book reminds us of the role of food and farming in the Black freedom movement. The activism of the people whose legacy this book recovers was tied to their love of the land. It helps us recognize that our relationship to the land is not just the story of oppression, but one of liberation. Land access and ownership gives us the power to heal ourselves. Monica's book tells the important stories of the land and the people and the institutions they created in order to resist. George Washington Carver, Tuskegee University, Fannie Lou Hamer, the Black agricultural cooperatives of the American South, Detroit's D-Town farmers, as well as many others whose names are lost to history, but whose resistance can be recovered in the archives that she painstakingly pieced together. Monica's book tells the story of resistance to oppression by those who stayed close to the land and fed themselves. This vital work in recovering the stories of the surviving members of these movements and their heirs is a healing balm. The Black land ethic is alive and well in these pages and in the contemporary urban food movement. By telling the history of our people on this land, Monica has given us all a magnificent gift. In recovering this story, she has revealed the strength, faith, and intelligence of the people who came before us. We stand on strong shoulders, holding on to the dream of freedom. They understood that the land could set them free. Tending the soil is one thing, but getting it to return life to you is another. Before this book, I looked for those stories. This work brings them into full view. It fills a tremendous void in our movement, providing a foundation that will reveal what food justice means for Black people in the 21st century. This book creates a foundation that is needed for the generations to come. The path to freedom is collective. We cannot do this individually. We need each other. We need our land and our food. Food is culture. The land holds our memories. The dominant white food narrative says that it is important to know where food comes from, who grew it, and who prepared it. However, what's needed is a narrative that connects food and land to our collective struggles and our history as Black people. This book is a conduit of those stories and memories that restore our dignity. I hope it will forever remind us that we are people of this land. LaDonna Redman, Campaign for Food Justice Now, November 3rd, 2017. Part 1, Land, Food, and Freedom. Introduction, Black Farmers, Agriculture, and Resistance. Quote, "It is pleasant to know that in color, form, and features, we are related to the first successful tillers of the soil, to the people who taught the world agriculture," end quote. Frederick Douglass, 1873. Quote, "There is no reason why the Negro should not control the Negro trade and handle the money the Negro has to spend," end quote. Reverend E. F. Love, 1888. Historians, novelists, filmmakers, and others engaged in casual conversation often tell the story of the relationship between landless African-American farmers and the soil as one of oppression and exploitation. Indeed, painful memories attend slavery, tenant farming, sharecropping, and land loss. But this book offers another narrative of the relationship between labor, land use, and the Black farmers whose contributions were intrinsic to the development of the agricultural sector of the United States of America. Recent scholarship has begun to describe the important role of Black landowners in organizing the civil rights movement, including those who provided lodging, food, and an organizational structure for freedom riders, facilitated voting rights organizing, and spearheaded anti-Jim Crow activism. Yet those who worked the land not only supported resistance strategies, they created and employed them. This book recovers the efforts of Black landowners as well as the civil rights activism of sharecroppers, tenant farmers, and domestic workers. It focuses its attention on those who refused to migrate and those who fought to stay in the South and maintain communities around agriculture. This book is an effort to recover, tell, and honor the stories of collective agency and community resilience of the Black rural poor, a group the civil rights movement left behind. Whether they worked the land part-time, as many domestic workers did, or full-time, whether they owned land or did not, their connection to Southern soil was the basis of their unity. The term farmers in this book's title refers to all those who worked the land, regardless of their land ownership status. This includes sharecroppers, tenant farmers, and landowners. In an earlier time, it even included those who were enslaved in rural places. It encompasses subsistence farmers, many of whom were women, who, after putting in long hours as domestic workers in rural settings, used their small amounts of free time to perform the gardening and farm work necessary for survival. Our historical memory has been profoundly affected by those narratives of the civil rights movement that, in emphasizing the talented tenth, have failed to capture the roles of Black working class men and women, and thus often have ignored the legacy of Black farmers and those who lived close to the land. This book documents forms of Southern rural resistance by which Black farmers responded to extreme conditions of repression, how they fought for the right to participate in the food system as producers and to earn a living wage in agriculture in the face of racially, socially, and politically repressive conditions, using land as a strategy to move toward freedom. It focuses on the agricultural cooperatives that these farmers created as the basis for self-reliant and self-determined community. By reclaiming that legacy, this book provides a historical foundation that will add meaning and perspective for the resurgence of agriculture in the context of contemporary food, justice, sovereignty movements in the United States, especially in cities such as Detroit, Chicago, Milwaukee, New York, and New Orleans. The post-agricultural society of the Jim Crow South left many Black Southerners homeless, unemployed, and hungry in the same way that post-industrial societies of the northern United States have left many Black factory workers homeless, unemployed, and hungry. Black farmers in the South engaged in agriculture as a way to survive when vast numbers of their peers joined the great migrations to the North and West. They pooled their resources in a way that produced a remarkable array of services, providing food, housing, education, employment, childcare, and healthcare collectively. These are lessons for underserved communities in today's cities that are attempting to identify ways of reorganizing their work, reimagining their communities, and rebuilding their neighborhoods with a commitment to social responsibility and environmental sustainability. This book illustrates how Black agricultural cooperatives using Freedom Farm Cooperative, FFC, North Bolivar County Farmers Cooperative, NBCFC, and the Federation of Southern Cooperatives, FSC, and the Detroit Black Community Food Security Network, DBC-FSN, as examples, engage in community development efforts as a strategy of resistance. It explains how, in response to extreme conditions of financial, social, and political oppression, Black farmers created agricultural cooperatives as a space and place to practice freedom. While their experiences with white politicians, landowners, and merchants left them feeling dependent, vulnerable, exploited, and fearful for their very lives, their cooperatives enacted strategies of prefigurative politics, economic autonomy, and commons as praxis. They demonstrated collective agency and community resilience, CACR, in working toward and practicing freedom. Freedom to participate in the political process, to engage in an economic model that was cooperative and fair, and to exchange ideas with others who shared their goals. These organizations offered the space to be innovative and practice a liberated community built upon the principles of cooperative living and self-sufficiency. One major objective of this book is to connect contemporary urban farmer activists to an earlier time when African Americans turned to agriculture as a strategy for building sustainable communities. As an activist and urban ethnographer of the food justice urban agriculture movement in Detroit since 2007, I have worked with others to transform and rebuild a financially devastated city. Across the generations, Black Detroiters are using agriculture as a way to convert vacant lots with overgrown grass into community gardens that serve as social spaces. These spaces now function as community centers where people learn about healthy eating, increase their access to healthy food, and receive health services. They are places where intergenerational relationships are nurtured and maintained, and where residents have a safe space for exercise. For many in Detroit, the new relationships they forge between land, food, and freedom are a response to the housing foreclosure crisis, the closing of public schools, the water shutoff crisis, and issues of policing. Theoretical framework, collective agency and community resilience. Collective agency and community resilience, CACR, is a theoretical framework that builds upon and amplifies the social movement concept of everyday strategies of resistance. James Scott and Benedict Kirkvliet use the term everyday strategies of resistance to refer to forms of resistance that are often overlooked or overshadowed by a focus on organized social movements. Everyday resistance typically is less confrontational, incurs less repression, and is usually enacted by individuals or small groups. It refers to, quote, what people do that reveals disgust, anger, or opposition to what they regard as unjust or unfair actions by others more wealthy or powerful than they, and the expressions of people who perceive injustice, but for various reasons are unable or unwilling to push improvements in an organized, direct manner, end quote. But even the study of everyday forms of resistance misses activities that are not disruptive, but rather constructive, in a sense that the aggrieved actively build alternatives to existing political and economic relationships. The acts of building knowledge, skills, community, and economic independence have a radical potential that the term does not encompass. We might then ask, is it possible to conceptualize these ways of building self-sufficiency and self-reliance as resistance in their own right? Offering new feminist, collective, community, and political dimensions, the framework of CACR captures the activities community members enact as a means to be self-reliant and self-sufficient. By recovering these acts of building sustainable communities through alternative community structures, I seek to complement studies of marches, sit-ins, boycotts, and other traditional means of protest with documentation of the alternative community structures that activists have created to meet community needs, whether social, political, or economic. Consistent with grounded theories, a concept of theoretical sensitivity, theories of social movements and resistance inform this framework. But CACR organically emerged from my coding and analysis of the archival documents and interviews I collected. Using methods of grounded theory, I constructed the framework as a way to encompass the vision and accomplishments of Black farm cooperatives. It is an attempt to represent the congealed wisdom and strategies that inform their efforts. Collective agency, a concept I coined based upon the data for this project, involves social actors' ability to create and enact behavioral options necessary to affect their political future. As such, it is an intrinsic part of social activism. How people understand and conceptualize their own agency affects their beliefs about whether they can influence the course of events in their own lives. Based on this information available to them and their interpretation of that information, their sense of agency allows them to make decisions either to resist or adhere to social boundaries. Those who join movements develop a type of agency that includes a willingness to give up their individual rewards granted by the hegemonic power of the social hierarchy and to find rewards in movement participation. Most scholarship on the concept of agency concentrates on its psychological origins and impact and its implications for the individual. I propose collective agency as a way to expand theories of agency to include a collective dimension. A community does not have a consciousness in the same way an individual does, but when a group of people comes together and believes in their mutual success, this creates a type of consciousness that drives collective agency. The concept of collective agency provides grounding for this book's investigation of those who share a collective identity and who join together in efforts to create new social forms. Community resilience, a subcategory within the burgeoning field of resilience science, refers to the various structural aspects and components of human adaptation to extreme adversity, using community as the unit of analysis. The theory of community resilience pays particular attention to the community-based forms of social organizing that plan for and respond to political violence, environmental climate change, and other forms of natural and human-induced disasters. It concentrates on ways to adjust, withstand, and absorb disturbance and to reorganize while undergoing change. It emphasizes structural approaches and community engagement, including types of indigenous knowledge, emotional experiences, intra-racial, interracial exchanges that communities need in order to adapt to unforeseen conditions. For example, when a community of farm workers faces the refusal of local merchants to sell them farm supplies and develops a cooperative to pool their resources to purchase those supplies from national merchants, they demonstrate resilience in the face of a system that benefits from their exploitation and their oppression. Strategies for collective agency and community resilience. The communities this book describes enacted CACR using three primary strategies that other theories of resistance have not adequately captured. These are 1, commons as praxis, 2, prefigurative politics, and 3, economic autonomy. These strategies, while not mutually exclusive, encompass the ideological, social, political, and economic aspects of community reliance and community determination as strategies for freedom and liberation. For example, a single institution such as a freedom school, a school created to educate Black children in the context of Jim Crow laws depriving them of public education, may be economically autonomous, but it may also be a demonstration of prefigurative politics and of commons as praxis. Commons as praxis. The development of commons as praxis is a critical transition in the ways that members of oppressed communities think and organize. Commons as praxis engages and contests dominant practices of ownership, consumerism, and individualism, and replaces them with shared social status and shared identities of race and class. It functions as an organizing strategy that emphasizes community well-being and wellness for the benefit of all. It is based on the premise that pooling resources can transcend the limitations of individual strength in oppressed communities. It emphasizes the shared ideology and the cooperative, collective behaviors that arise in response to the conditions of oppression. Community decisions made around shared spaces and resources such as access to land, water, and seeds are examples of commons as praxis. Prefigurative politics. Prefigurative politics refers to the construction of alternative political systems that are democratic and include processes of self-reflection. Also referred to as everyday utopias, place-based alternative practices, and alternative experiments in everyday living, prefigurative politics involves several progressive components, including free spaces and democratic representation. Prefigurative politics begins with the awareness that members of a group have been excluded from the political process. The group responds by developing free spaces to meet without fear of repression, to share their grievances, and to foster and discuss innovative ideas that will help them move toward freedom and liberation. Free spaces are critical for understanding, interrogating, and engaging democratic and revolutionizing principles that stand in stark contrast to the structures identified as oppressive. Through political education, community members engage in consciousness raising and information exchange, which allows them to think creatively about the current political situation and how they would reconceptualize those arrangements. It also allows them to consider alternative ways of engagement with power that includes principles of community self-determination and community self-reliance. At the individual level, prefigurative politics introduces community members to new ideas that encourage new ways of being, along with a greater sense of freedom and independence, and thus create the opportunity to move from conditions of oppression to conditions of self-sufficiency and self-determination. At the community level, the spaces prefigurative politics creates are locations where members of oppressed groups are able to speak freely, strategize, and offer political education and politicization to members of the group. They can move from describing and discussing conditions of oppression to strategizing and conceptualizing movement toward freedom and liberation. Within these spaces, members engage in democratic practices. Community members create the opportunity to practice democracy when they have been excluded from it in the rest of the world. Once a community creates and initiates new ways of decision-making and political autonomy, an economically independent and autonomous community becomes apparent and necessary. Economic autonomy. Given the economic and racial exploitation in the history of Southern agriculture, including structures of sharecropping, tenant farming, and Jim Crow legislation, economic autonomy is a critical dimension of collective agency and community resilience. In response to economic exploitation, and in opposition to a resource extraction model in which all forms of economic participation support the status quo, efforts to establish economic autonomy create an alternative system of resource exchange within the community, and these funds and resources have direct benefits for all of its members. The pursuit of economic autonomy allowed communities to provide for their members financially and to help them move from dependence to independence, from powerlessness toward a position of power. Economic autonomy often involves creating an alternative economic system, such as replacing the exchange of federal currency with barter of labor or produce. Building economic autonomy thus creates a platform for working to end social, political, and economic oppression. By developing an independent system, a community could begin to extract its members from an oppressive system at the same time that it built capacity through fostering new forms of collective self-governance. In the South, prior to establishing cooperatives, tenant farmers and sharecroppers often had experiences that left them feeling economically dependent, their labor exploited, and themselves discarded. The creation of institutions that enhanced their economic autonomy offered a powerful alternative. Yet economic autonomy is in fact an ideal and is always a matter of degree in a globalized economy. The people who see themselves as economically autonomous in today's world, wealthy Americans, most of them white, in fact depend on a host of factors and government subsidies and frequently the labor of those less powerful than themselves to retain their economic power. Thus, the economic autonomy that cooperatives seek is a process, a continuum that moves from complete dependence on an oppressive structure to independence. Arguably, in a global economy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.